welcome to the New York Society Library. It's my great pleasure tonight to introduce Laurence Bergreen and his latest book, Casanova, The World of a Seductive Genius. I'm Carol Malone, I'm the chairman of the library and until recently the chair of the Lecture and Exhibitions Committee. Mr. Bergreen will be familiar to many of you, not only as the author of best-selling biographies of Columbus and Magellan and Marco Polo, but also as a member of our board of trustees. With these biographies, he has led us beyond the stereotypes that each of us associate with the various adventures he's written about. And here, once again, he takes us beyond the Casanova we think we know, to an appreciation of an infinitely more complex character. Mr. Bergreen has engaged in an impressive amount of research for this volume. He's consulted the archives in Venice, Paris, and the Czech Republic. And in large part, the reason for this book, he tells me, is that he discovered that the French National Library, the Bibliothèque Nationale, has made available to us online all 12 volumes of Casanova's memoirs, which are written in French. And to the French, Casanova is a man of letters, something that many of us in this country don't realize. Well, who was Casanova? A personality whose intelligence, charm, and gift for opportunism led him throughout Europe, from the court of Louis XV to the court of Catherine the Great. He spent time in Cyprus and London, all throughout Paris and Italy. And in this book, we meet popes, princes, Venetian aristocrats, actors and actresses, courtesans, common prostitutes, card sharks, sailors, and in some, the high life and the low life, and many in between. But the success of Mr. Bergreen's account lies not only in his scholarship, but in the sheer pleasure afforded to us when we read his book. He's recreated the astonishing world of the 18th century in Europe, and coincidentally, our library was founded in the year Casanova was 19, and Casanova's love affairs, by the time he turned 19, would stand our hair on end. And so we here are within 6 degrees of separation from Mr. Bergreen's subject. In fact, Casanova helped Mozart and his librettist, Lorenzo de Ponte, put together their opera Don Giovanni, Don Juan. And as many of you may know, when Lorenzo de Ponte eventually gets to America, he comes and becomes a professor of Italian at Columbia University, and his books and manuscripts are housed in our library. So, there we are. Finally, to quote Mr. Bergreen's preface, each love affair was for Casanova a meeting of mind and spirit, a glimpse of eternity and ecstasy. So Casanova's love affairs were psychological love affairs, not merely physical ones. And with that, please join me in welcoming Mr. Bergreen.
Speaking of libraries and frequenting this library ever since about 1970, and so I've come to feel that it's sort of a second home. For Casanova, libraries were very important. Oh, if you can't hear me, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, great. For Casanova, libraries were very important, and his two favorite places in the world were libraries and brothels. He found different kinds of stimulation in both places, but he spent the last 15 years of his life as a librarian in a large castle outside of Prague, and he was a very serious, knowledgeable reader. He spoke several languages. He knew Greek, he knew Latin, he translated the Odyssey and the Aeneid into Italian from their original languages. So he always fancied himself a writer. We know him as a joke, especially in North America. A number of people asked me while I was working on this book, what was it like to work on a person who was a folklore figure, not a real person, somebody like Paul Bunyan or a legend or something like that. They would never ask that question in France, at least probably not. So I explained that actually he was a real person, and he actually lived, and he was from Venice in 1725, and people wondered, how does one research Casanova? Actually, he's done a phenomenal job of researching his own life with his memoirs. But it's not just what he wrote about his own life, it's what everybody in the 18th century wrote. If you're familiar with other biographies of figures from that era, they're often very fat because people have so much to say. They're very verbose, and Casanova didn't merely write to people, people wrote to him. So there's a lot of letters, for example, of a number of his paramours also wrote to him extensively. You can compare his comments and thoughts and feelings with theirs. Sometimes they match and sometimes they didn't. After all, he was Casanova. Also, by the way, in his own lifetime, Casanova was not exactly a nobody, but he was a minor figure. He was a footnote. The well-known member of his family was his mother, Zanetta Ferrucci. And we'll get to some pictures of her and Venice in a minute. She was a famous actress and courtesan in the Commedia dell'arte. And she acted in plays that were highly improvised by Goldoni and was well known across Europe. She performed in London and settled and retired in Prague. She abandoned Casanova when he was a child, a young child, and he was left to the care of his virtually illiterate grandmother, who lived on another island, much smaller island, in the Venetian lagoon. So this left a gaping hole in Casanova's psyche, which it seemed to me, as his biographer, he spent his entire life trying to fill. A couple of weeks ago, I was speaking to a symposium of about 40 psychiatrists at Mount Sinai Hospital uptown, and I was pleased to know that they mostly agreed with that idea. At least nobody took strenuous exception to it. So that gives some idea of what was driving Casanova, but the other part of it is that he was a libertine, and that meant he had license to do whatever he wanted to because he was free and he believed in freedom. There were two parts of being a libertine. One part was intellectual freedom of thought, and when we think of the Enlightenment, especially in North America and to a certain extent in England, we think of the Age of Reason, we think of Hobbes, we think of Rousseau, we think of Voltaire, we think of various mathematicians. But in France, the Enlightenment, La Lumière, also means a freedom of sexual expression. That means a lot of what we would call orgies or promiscuity. They wouldn't have used those terms. They would just say you were free to do what you want. Casanova, therefore, really wasn't an exception in his time. He was more or less the rule. There were a lot of Casanovas running around, male and female, at his time, in his time, including his mother. The other Casanova, who was kind of well known, was his younger brother Francesco, who was a painter and was established in Paris, has some paintings in the Louvre, was a member of the French Academy, and made something of himself as a landscape painter. Casanova used to occasionally visit him when he was going through Paris to mock him and his bourgeois comforts, but also to borrow money when he needed it. So you can see that Casanova was a kind of a scapegrace figure. People would have been surprised at the extent of his literary ambition, which I think his behavior managed to distract people from. When he met Voltaire, he kind of forced his way into his presence. Voltaire looked down on him, as he did on many people, but wondered who was this upstart Venetian, this parvenu, and who seemed to consider them on the same level. It was preposterous. Voltaire was one of the most famous men of letters at that time, and Casanova was practically a nobody. He was always writing, by the way, and often publishing. Venice, where he was from, had a very lively press. There were dozens of newspapers that were published every day. Most of them were gossipy. He wrote anonymous poems and articles for them. He wrote a 3-volume science fiction novel. Science fiction was a new genre. I tried reading it, but I have to tell you, I couldn't quite make it through more than just a small part of it. It's called the Icosameron. It's some sort of a takeoff on the Decameron. He also wrote plays, translations, as I mentioned before, and polemics, some political philosophy. All of this marked him as a man of the Enlightenment, and that he took an interest in almost anything and everything. But most people, if they knew Casanova, the first word that would have come to mind was gambler. He was a very successful gambler, and he happened to come from Venice, which was the Las Vegas of his day. It was the center of sex tourism, and tourists came from across Europe to Venice to gamble and to sample the courtesans and prostitutes, the way people would go to Las Vegas perhaps today. There were at least 10,000 courtesans in tiny Venice at that point. If you've been there, you know how small it is. Many of them, and many of the most desirable ones, were in convents. I'll show you some pictures of them. You remember Hamlet when he's furious at Ophelia, says, "Get thee to a nunnery, go." Often the actor shouts that. Well, what he meant was nunnery was another word for a brothel. He was basically calling her a prostitute or a whore. The nuns in Venice, not all of them, but many of them, were the daughters of wealthy families who confined them behind bars so that they couldn't get married and couldn't get pregnant and couldn't dilute the family lines in Venice. There were 400 families who ruled Venice, and they were all in the so-called Golden Book, Libro d'Oro. And they tried to keep them out of harm's way as long as they could. So one of the things they did to try and do this was to essentially keep them behind bars. However, it didn't really work out that way, because after a while, people in charge of these convents, some of them were nuns, some of them were priests, began a lively trade in tourists coming there, having parties, and having orgies or encounters either on the grounds or sneaking out at night, meeting in various places nearby, and then coming back by dawn. Well, how do we know all this? First of all, Casanova wrote about it in great detail described exactly what it was like in a sort of a you are there sort of way. Other people, other tourists, wrote accounts that bore it out. Time and again, I was struck by some of Casanova's statements that seemed over the top, perhaps the product of his imagination, too extreme. How could this be? And lo and behold, there were many other tourists or letter writers or people who knew him who were writing about the same thing. So Casanova wasn't a fantasist. He was really recording a social reality of Venice at that time, which was in its last throes. The Venetian Empire was almost 1,000 years old at that point. And Casanova actually inadvertently had a hand in its downfall. I'll explain that in a minute. Let's see how this works. There is Casanova. Oh, just to back up for a second, he was not handsome. He was described as being tall and ungainly. His skin was described as being tinted, and whoops, we went too far back. There we go. He also dressed, and I'll show you the costume, Venetian style most of the time, which meant a tight satin suit covered by voluminous capes, a tri-cornered hat, and a mask. Women wore masks, and men wore masks, not just at carnival, not just this time of year, which is carnival, but year-round by law. So they wore them on the streets, and they even wore them indoors. So that was a fact of life in Venice. Visitors, by the way, tourists didn't wear masks by law. It was just the Venetians. I wasn't even sure why. I did a lot of research, or some research, trying to figure out how this custom started, but seemed to be as old as Venice itself, and part of Venice, and still survives now in a sort of smaller form at carnival time. Nevertheless, he managed to get the attention of women because he was a smooth talker, and he was always putting himself on display. So he managed to go wherever the women go, and was often shameless in his pursuit of them. This was Casanova's Venice, and I bet many of you have been there, so it hasn't really changed that much since his day. He didn't live on the canal or on the Grand Canal or anything like that. I'll show you the house where he was born and spent his early years, which was kind of in a back alley almost, much more modest circumstances. His father, who had died young, was also an actor, but not as well known as his mother. So Casanova really was almost orphaned at a very early age when his mother abandoned him and his father died young. So he fended for himself. Here you get some idea of the costumes of Venice during carnival time, and which was an even bigger deal then than it is now. Again, some of the Venetian costumes. And here was the classic Venetian costume that you would see indoors, outdoors, on the street, daytime, nighttime. The mask, the bauta, and these long flowing garments. You can see the men and the women look strikingly similar. Now, these costumes really affected behavior because it gave license or cover for a lot of people to commit crimes, murders, to throw people in the canal and get rid of them. So they could literally get away with murder wearing the masks, which were prescribed by law. So Venice was known as a very dangerous place, among other things, as well as being a very licentious place. Here's a modern version of the masks. And women sometimes wore this black mask known as a moretta. And as you can see, it covered their face, and they held it in place with a button between their teeth, so they couldn't speak. So welcome to Venice. And, but on the other hand, women, because of their desirability as courtesans and occasionally their wealth, which they acquired through marriage, could also be inordinately powerful. In general, they were supposed to keep themselves, at a remove and at a distance. But as you can imagine, there was a great deal of hypocrisy regarding how women were supposed to behave. Here's a map of Casanova's Venice with some of the highlights. You may notice here the Redonto was their main gambling area. It was abolished during Casanova's lifetime, but that was the mecca for most of the tourists who were going to Venice. And it's where Casanova learned how to gamble, which was a talent that stood him in good stead. Here I am when I was there, standing in front of his house, where he was born. And you can see it was rather modest, but that was Casanova's neighborhood. And now we're sort of jumping ahead. This was what awaited him in France, in Paris, at Versailles when he got there. This was one of the many mistresses of Louis XV, who was known by reputation in Venice. Venetians often felt themselves to be kind of a poor relation of Paris. Paris was where things were happening. So it was the city of that people aspired to go to. It was where the latest fashions came from, the latest intellectual trends, the best-known writers. When Casanova started writing his memoirs, he wrote in French. It never would have occurred to him to write them in the Venetian dialect, which he grew up speaking. French was the language of the intelligentsia. This was a typical Venetian woman with typical Venetian beauty marks, and Venetian women were celebrated around Europe for their alluring, flirtatious, and quality. This was a woman who Casanova fell in love with, and he describes their relationship in great detail. She, Teresa Lante, posed as a castrato, but she was a woman. And there was, castrati were very much in demand as singers at that time. This, after all, was the age of opera and bel canto. There weren't enough castrati to go around, so many women tried to pass themselves off as them. Casanova was very drawn to her when he first met her, when she was disguised as a man, and was very confused, and he describes his sexual confusion at a considerable length. Was she a man? What was she, a woman? What did it mean? And she tried to convince him that she was actually a man. And he describes in great detail a prosthesis that she wore to mimic male parts. And apparently she wasn't the only faux castrato who was doing this. And it was really extraordinary. So he takes you into this very private, secret, lost world of castrato impersonators, if you will. And she became one of his first love affairs. Later on, she became well known in her own right as Teresa Lante, as a woman. You can see her here in her very, very elaborate getup. But she was a very important early love of Casanova's, but also very unsettling because of her ambiguous sexuality. Another facet of Casanova was of Casanova's day there. Was the Doge. Doge means ducks or leader, the chief of Venice, and this was his ship, Bucentaur. Once a year in May, he got on that ship and it went out and he threw a wedding ring into the lagoon. And why? To symbolize the marriage of Venice and the sea. This gives you some sense of what a mystical place Venice was, and even in the Age of Enlightenment, in the Age of Reason, so-called, it remained as mystical as ever. Here we have some more Venetians. They're gambling at the Redotto, as you can see. You can see the masks. Maybe they're tourists. Maybe they're Venetians. Here was, I mentioned the nuns earlier. Here is one of the nun/courtesans. Who were popular in Casanova's day. This wasn't just in Venice. This was happening also in other cities. There was a kind of an underground I don't know what you want to call it, licentious nuns in Paris as well. There was a very, very vivid literature about them. Their pseudo-confessions, sometimes their real confessions of their lives behind the walls of various convents. Casanova, as a libertine, was one of the first people. He was an early adopter, if you will, of this technology for birth control, the condom. Condoms were the new thing. They were made in England. They came into Venice. He was very happy to get a hold of them. Any man in Venice who could get his hands on a condom was guaranteed a date. And here he is blowing one up, and two of the gentlemen showing off. They didn't work very well, so they tended to come off during activities and how much pregnancy they prevented is anyone's guess. There was a lively trade, sad to say, in Venice in abortion at that time, and in the convents as well. Casanova describes in gruesome, agonizing detail a young nun giving birth having an abortion, and another case having a stillbirth there, and it's really sad and wrenching to read. But this was part of Casanova's life. Here's an actual party or celebration inside one of the convents at San Zaccaria. And you can get some idea of what it's like. Why there are children there, I don't really know. And I assume as the night wore on, the party got wilder and wilder. But some of the most uninhibited events actually took place when the women who were there, the nuns and their guests, snuck outside for a few hours. Casanova describes their sport in considerable detail. He was caring in love, particularly with two nuns who were both young. When they weren't around, they were carrying on with each other He describes some of their relationships as well. So you get an idea of what a complicated, fascinating, decadent time this was. Eventually, when Casanova was about 30, he was imprisoned. We don't really know why. He was never really formally charged. But there was a very oppressive, omnipresent Venetian Inquisition. And there were spies everywhere. And some spies broke into his apartment and saw that he had forbidden books. These were books that was the Kabbalah, which had been Christianized about that time and was very popular, and some other books about numerology that were considered forbidden mystical texts. Apparently that was enough for him to be arrested. And he was sent to the most dreaded prison in Venice at that time, I Piombi, the Leads, which was in the roof of the Doge's palace. If you've ever been to the Doge's palace, you know, there's a big staircase, which is famous, and if you go all the way up and above that, above the roof, as if it were above this roof, there were a series of cells, one of which I stood in, which was Casanova's. They were totally dark. They were just huge, airless closets. Mm-hmm. And they were called the Leads because the roof was lead-lined, which meant that they were stifling in the summer, very hot in the winter. Very cold in the winter. And Casanova was put in isolation there with no real contact with the outside world. Occasionally a guard would bring him some food, but he thought that he was going to die there. He wanted to escape. This seemed like an impossible task because nobody had ever escaped from the Leads, from I Piombi. So this was a very difficult task, but over a period of many months, he concocted a plan to dig his way out. He bribed the guard, he got a hold of some tools which he carefully hid, and he describes in his memoirs in great detail how he effected this escape. It's a little bit like escape from Alcatraz, in the sense that he managed to, you know, simulate that he was sleeping or doing something else when guards were around. And this took many, many months to dig his way out. He got some help eventually from the prisoner in the next cell with whom he communicated. They managed to pass notes back and forth. This was Father Balbi, who was a defrocked priest. He had several girlfriends with whom he had children, and this was enough to earn him a trip to England. He really didn't want to risk an escape, because they might lose their lives, but Casanova kind of pulled him into it, didn't give him much choice. And so after months of digging, one night they finally escaped through the roof, and Casanova describes how they did this, how they had a rope, how they crossed the roof, how they let themselves down to the ground, and how they walked as fast as they possibly could to a gondola and got the heck out of Venice. And he didn't go back for 18 years, because if he did, he would have been arrested. Oh, this picture, this was Casanova, as you can see in the upper left-hand corner, lowering himself from the roof of the Doge's palace. This is an artist's representation, of course, and here's another one of the same event. We know so much about it because Casanova wrote a book about it, Ma Fuite, My Escape, a few years later, which was very popular. And so he became known as the man who had escaped I Piombi, the one and only man. Father Balbi also escaped, but after a while he kind of got tired of running and he allowed himself to be recaptured and he was sent back to Venice and followed a different path. But Casanova kept going and he wanted to get to Paris, which was the city that everyone aspired to be. Almost the same day that he got there, this fellow, Damiens, tried to assassinate King Louis XV. Casanova was on the scene, incredibly enough, and described all the commotion and what he saw. Louis XV was often put himself on display. Damiens was, as this picture suggests, sort of a madman, and didn't actually kill him, although he tried to, but he sort of scraped him and tore his garment. This was enough to cause a great outcry throughout Paris, and He was soon tried. Casanova thought this was all a huge overreaction, since he actually hadn't done that much damage. But to the French, the monarchy was tottering at that point. This sort of brought all the apprehensions about the stability of their government bubbling to the surface. And Damiens met with an incredibly cruel fate, which Casanova intended. He was drawn and quartered in Paris in 1757. Casanova was there, and he wrote about what it was like, about the hot lead being poured onto his skin, about his arms and legs being pulled off by horses. You can see the horses there. And he was disillusioned, to put it mildly, by the French, because here were these people who were supposed to be the most sophisticated, the most civilized people anywhere in Europe, behaving in a way that was absolutely barbaric. Casanova, you know, was duly warned. By the way, there was even more here than you can see in this picture. While this was going on, according to Casanova, there were a number of people who had taken booths or rooms with a view of this execution, and were having orgies while they were watching it go on. I know it sounds incredible, but that's what happened. Casanova wasn't the only one to report on what it was like in Paris when he got there. On the other hand, in the court of Louis XV, you had, you know, an air of refinement. Madame de Pompadour was the mistress-in-chief of Louis XV, and organized all his many other mistresses, and kept the court running smoothly. Casanova knew her fairly well, not very well, but has a few stories about her. And meanwhile, the king's wife often sat by herself, eating by herself, while his much more colorful mistresses were having a kind of an endless party in what was in effect the king's harem. This was one of Casanova's first girlfriends in Paris, Manon Belletti. She was Venetian, so was her family, but they had also made it to Paris. As you can tell, she was very beautiful, and she was in love with Casanova. I quote some of her love letters to him, because she was imploring him, beseeching him to marry her, and he wouldn't. He was in love with her, and he wanted to sleep with her, which he did. And his family embraced him when he got to Paris, but he wouldn't marry her. One of his sayings that he liked to repeat throughout his life is that marriage is the tomb of love. So he remained opposed to marriage throughout his life. In his later years, he regretted it. He lived to regret it, because he was often alone, relatively speaking, and lonely, and didn't have the consolation of friends and children and relations that other people did. But as a libertine, especially as a young libertine, he was fleeing from people like Manon Belletti and others, who Italian and French, who wanted to have Casanova as his, as a spouse. Part of the reason he seemed desirable in their eyes was that he was, among other things, a very accomplished con artist. And he couldn't fool Madame Belletti, because she knew where he came from. But to other people, he posed as the Chevalier de Saint-Gall, which was a made-up name. It's as if I stood before you and said that I was Colonel Sanders. And it was as preposterous as that. But he managed to get away with it and get into various parties and insinuate himself into various courts and events around Europe, especially in Germany, as the Chevalier de Saint-Gall. And because he learned French fairly quickly, he passed himself off as a minor European nobility. If anybody had discovered his real background as the son of two Venetian actors, they would have considered him an outcast. So he went through much of his adult life with this invented persona, and as a posing as something that he wasn't. Here's, you know, some of the life that he saw around him or participated in Paris, which was a continuous party in his description all the time, but not just his, also other people wrote about Casanova's, the Venice of Casanova's day, and they all kind of coincide. Here was a brothel, like a sketch. I think it was taken from life to give you some idea of what the inside of a brothel was, and Casanova also frequented brothels. Even as he was trying to become a man of letters and not getting very far in Paris, the way he finally made a name for himself, we'll get to the Fandango in Portugal later, was through his gambling ability. He heard through his connections, because he was a terrific social climber, that the Venetian crown was desperate for money. And they could not tax people anymore because the government was about to crumble. There were rumbles of a revolution, and yet they needed money. Well, Casanova was familiar with various lotteries in Italy, especially the Genoese lottery, and he adapted it for Paris. He went to talk to the people who were in charge of fundraising a revenue for the French crown and sold them out on the idea of a more refined, sophisticated version of an Italian lottery. They were very concerned that if anybody hit it in the beginning after buying tickets, that they would be broke and it would be a disaster. And Casanova persuaded them by insisting that that's exactly what he hoped would happen, because the publicity of somebody winning a lottery in the beginning would inspire many, many people to go out and buy tickets. And he explained to them through the laws of probability, which he understood, probability was a mathematical concept that had gained a lot of traction at that time, how they couldn't actually go broke as long as they kept the number of tickets they sold under control, which was what happened. So in short order, a number of lottery ticket stores opened up around Paris. The Parisians bought the tickets like hotcakes. Casanova got a cut of some of them, and he became the proprietor of a couple of these stores. So he suddenly had money for the first time in his life. He really had real money, he was considered a very helpful, handy person to know in Paris because of the lottery. Unfortunately, it didn't last that long. Casanova decided to go on to a unwise business venture. At that time, silk painted in the Chinese manner was very fashionable with women, so he decided to open up a factory and hire a lot of young girls to paint the silk and sell it, and he imagined himself making a lot of money doing this. The only problem was he wound up having affairs with all the girls who worked with him. Some of them became pregnant, and the expense involved and the chaos that he caused was beyond belief. So this factory closed down after a while, and it was a disaster. And he was almost back to square one. So you can see a pattern with Casanova of a brilliance and a self-destructive side, a side that adored and venerated women, but was also very destructive and exploitative toward women as well. So Casanova was a fascinating combination of opposites. After he left Paris in search of new adventures, he went through Spain and Portugal. He had more adventures there. They weren't that much to his liking. He found Spain very severe and joyless after Paris, although he had a few successful seductions there that he wrote about. And again, some families wanted their daughters to marry him, and again, he ran away before that could happen. Then he went back in the other direction and went toward Prague, where he ran into this fellow, who's well known to this library, Lorenzo de Ponte, who was also from Venice. But they didn't know each other back in Venice. They met in the area of Prague. Prague was sort of the second Paris. It was a center of culture and art, and brilliant social life at that time. And that's where Mozart was at work with de Ponte on the opera Don Giovanni. Now, that was a genre of operas, and so this was the latest entrance, but he wanted his to be better than the others. And of course, it was Mozart. De Ponte was scratching around for ideas for the libretto. He was a drinking, gambling, and whoring companion of Casanova's, and Casanova told him a few stories about his exploits, some of which made it into the libretto. We don't know exactly, you know, how literal they were, but he gave them some inspiration. De Ponte introduced Casanova to Mozart as a real-life Don Giovanni or real-life Don Juan, you know, as a libertine. And then Casanova went to the opening in Prague of Don. Imagine going to the opening of Don Giovanni in Prague. Mm-hmm. He was very disappointed because at the end, as you know, Don Giovanni goes to hell. Casanova, no one. He didn't see the point. What did he do wrong? What did he do to earn his trip to hell? He didn't see it. So you can see Casanova had a different moral perspective on Don Juan's activities than Mozart and maybe the rest of us do. Here is a part of the manuscript. There are some people who examine the manuscript and say they see contributions in the handwriting of Mozart, De Ponte, and Casanova in it. So anyway, he was part of the zeitgeist surrounding it. His mother was in Prague at that point, living in retirement. And you may say, oh, how wonderful that he had a reunion with his mother. But whatever he describes her in his later years, even though she was his closest living relative, his mother, he had very little of any feeling to say about her. He wrote about other women with great feeling, and some of them were apparently mother figures. But his own mother, he had not much to say about, which was interesting, and they had kind of arm's length relationship. So they didn't have all that much to do with each other occasionally. At one point he writes about her performing in a translation of a play, his translation of a play. But nevertheless, they don't really seem to have been any sort of collaborators. And, you know, there's a great absence there. He writes with much more feeling about his brothers than he does about his mother. In his later years, he fell on hard times. He was running out of money. His lifestyle had taken its toll. He had, by his count, 11 cases of venereal disease. We don't know. It's hard to diagnose these things over the centuries, but maybe it was the same one that kept coming back. Maybe it was different ones. It was probably the same one that kept returning. There was no cure for venereal disease at that point. Everyone who had it took mercury. That was by far the most popular. But that was just poisoning yourself. But he would isolate himself, take mercury, the venereal disease outbreak would recede, he would consider himself cured, and then he would go forth again. He really wasn't cured. But not until the 1940s, with sulfa drugs, was there any kind of cure for venereal disease. In his later years, and you can see there, he's 62, suddenly looking much older. Because he loved libraries so much, he got a job at Dux, a castle outside of Prague, a huge castle, and he became the librarian, and that's where he finally sat still long enough to write his memoirs. He didn't get through his whole life. He died before he was done. He got up to his mid-50s. You know, it was a huge outpouring of literature, plus other works as well. It was not letters, other memoirs, essays, so he spent a great deal of time writing. None of this was published in his lifetime. Oh, this was the chair in which he died. And it's there in Dux Castle with a rose on it. That was a picture I took when I visited. He was not known as any kind of a writer in his lifetime. These many volumes were kept by his family, and then by in-laws of his family, of his cousins and children, and it was only 30 or 40 years afterward, one could write a book about the posthumous history of his memoirs, that some of them began to appear in German translation, suddenly he made a name for himself based just on these excerpts, because he gave such a full and frank and detailed discussion of what life was like, how the seductions happened, what the people were like, what Voltaire was like, what the corruption was like in Venice. And, you know, it's a, if you read it, as I did, it was almost like a highly detailed novel of behavior, of social history. It was many years until a full version appeared. And it was really only until the 1960s that the full French version appeared, and an English translation by Boulard-Trance, which was a heroic task to translate that. In my opinion, the French is really better because it captures all his irony and wit and his wonderful word choice. And the English is a little more plodding, but it's there. Now when I was working on this book, and because of the newly acquired manuscript that Carol mentioned by the Bibliothèque Nationale, it was re-edited and republished in France, in French anyway, not once, but twice, by two different competing publishing companies. So each one claiming to have the authentic, authorized edition of it, but more complete than ever, which meant they were more explicit than ever. So it's only recently that we can really see, you know, all of Casanova in his own words. And anyway, that's a little bit about him. That was another one of his phrases. People were always coming up with bold in those days, so that was another one I'd like to come up with. And any questions that you have, I'll try to answer. Anybody have any questions or thoughts? Yes.
Did he keep diaries, or was most of the memoir done just from letters and his own memory?
That's a really good question. I think he kept diaries and kept letters because he describes having boxes and trunks full of writing, his writings, and throughout his life. But we don't really have those earlier documents. What we have are the manuscripts, but he couldn't have recreated all this strictly from memory.
Yeah.
And of course, I wondered a lot while I was writing the book, well, how much of this really happened, and how much of it was, you know, a novel in a sense. But anytime I checked out, was he where he said he was, or with, you know, with this woman or that woman, or doing what he said he was doing, the answer was yes. And he didn't make stuff up. Of course, his personal impressions about people are subjective, you know, they're his personal impressions. But even in the romances, when we have letters from the women, you know, they match what he's writing about. So, yes.
Who's the couple on the cover? They seem to be a later period than Casanova.
Oh.
And why did you choose them?
Well, actually, the publisher chose them. And that's a later 19th century, early 19th century couple. And I think they just wanted something that would suggest the romantic intensity of Casanova's life. But, you know, I really had nothing to do with it. The publisher said, here's your cover. And I said, okay. So that's welcome to publishing. Yes.
Early in your book, you introduce an interesting hypothesis that Casanova may have thought himself to be the illegitimate son
yes.
of a Venetian
yes.
nobleman.
Yeah. Yeah. This is part of the persistent Casanova lore, and there may be something to it. In Venice, there was a legend, a rumor, gossip, that he was actually, his father wasn't the actor who had died when he was young. But he was actually the illegitimate son of a nobleman who was helpful to the family. But there's really no proof of that. Casanova, when he got older, fancied himself to be, but this was part of his sort of delusion of grandeur, along with being a chevalier de Saint-Gall, fancied himself the illegitimate son of this nobleman. But there was never any way to link it. The full answer may never be known, but there's certainly no way to prove it.
Tell me, what would be the fascination of 19th century and even 20th century Paris with Casanova in terms of publishing or collecting all of his works and everything and purchasing them for the National Museum, which I think...
Why did they... Because he is considered in France to be this kind of living... well, his lifetime repository of stories and anecdotes and behavior that became an archetype. You know, there were other libertines, but there was only one Casanova. There were other people who kept diaries, but you know, there's nobody else who kept one with this extraordinary amount of detail and eloquence. If you start reading the passages, I mean, they are phenomenally eloquent and almost hypnotizing. I read it myself two or three times because it was just so fascinating to dip into it. And then, you know, I kept going and going and going. I wanted to know what happened in the next volume. There are also sections that are very dramatic, like his escape from jail. So all of this added to the reputation or legend of Casanova. It was as if he was an archetype that somehow sprang to life. Yes?
Was there any public figure he particularly admired, such as Voltaire, or was he generally either cynical or jaded about his literary subjects?
Well, he particularly, I mean, I think he wanted to be Voltaire, you know, a literary man of importance, wealthy, you know, widely respected. And that's a very interesting question about cynicism. I think he was very cynical about people in general. I mean, acidly cynical. But I'd say outside of Voltaire, there was no one who really struck him as being, you know, worthy of admiration, except for figures from antiquity, because, you know, he was trained in Latin and Greek, so he read a lot of classical authors and aspired to emulate them. But he was living in a time that, you know, was very different. It was also a time where people wrote so much that, we have extraordinary documentation of. Anytime people got together for a dinner party, you know, everybody went home and wrote three, four letters about what they did and what they said and what was served, and so it's sort of overwhelming, actually. Yes.
Did he meet Catherine the Great?
Pardon?
When did he?
Oh yeah, he met Catherine the Great kind of early on. She was in about 30. She had recently become Empress of Russia. They did not, I'm sorry to say, have an affair. She was terrified, but he had got as far east as Russia, and he insinuated himself as this Chevalier de Saint-Gall into her court. And he gives a detailed description of their conversations. She wanted to know about Western weights and measures and timekeeping. He was trying to westernize her, and I don't think he really succeeded, but he was very impressed by her formidable intellect. Did you have?
I'm just curious, did you have to do all this research in French?
I would say, yeah, mostly in French. There's a lot of it that's been translated into English. There was some also in Italian, kind of support materials as well. So, you know, it was interesting, it was fun, it was a kind of taxing. The difficult part was boiling it down to something. This book is already really on the long side, but it was a lot longer because there's just so much to say about this subject. Everybody's extremely verbose. Yes.
Well, where was he educated? Did he learn Greek and Roman?
Oh, he was trained. He was trained as a priest in Venice because this was a traditional avenue for children of poor families who were intelligent. As a priest, he would have a secure livelihood. But by the time he was about 19. He left the priesthood. He describes how he started giving sermons, and he was so attracted to the women that it was very distracting for him. But he actually met one who was the Pope at that time on an early trip to Rome, and did see a path for himself as a priest through his life, but then that was really not consistent with being a libertine. So he chose the other way.
Yes. I'm interested when you say that he lived in France after the Great and Prague. Was this normal that people were so international?
I don't know if it was normal. I think people did. I think he was doing what wealthy people or aristocrats did in those days, but I don't know how normal it was. He was constantly on the move. He traveled around in stagecoach, which is not very comfortable, sometimes on foot. Often walked many, many, many miles. So he rarely stayed in one place very long until he was older and beginning to get frail when he was at Dux and writing his memoirs.
What age was he then?
He was about 60 and 62 and beginning to really feel his age. You know, there are descriptions of him, people who knew him, who said, you know, his hair turned white and, you know, he just gave an appearance of seeming elderly, and So he stayed there. He was down to only two or three girlfriends at this point. One of whom was a young nun. There was another one he often described his inability to perform with them and how disappointing that was to him. So he was suffering the pangs of old age. And so I said, I think, you know, the sort of a sub-theme there was this sense of loneliness that he had never married, and now that, you know, those days were behind him. What he had was this incredible storehouse of memories, you know, documents he wanted to write about. Yes?
Did you ever gain any international fame or more? When this book came to the United States, it wasn't like treated like, you know, some of Ponte and other books.
Yeah, he did. He did gain some internationally, but it wasn't a kind of a scandal in the way of a Ulysses or Arthur Miller book in the 1920s. Partly because the translations were pretty expurgated; they just weren't that naughty. And in this country, you know, the Casanova didn't speak to people as much as it did to people in Europe, and so he's seen as a much more important figure there, and he wasn't taken that seriously here. I think now, you know, he's taken more seriously than he used to be, partly because of his literary accomplishments, and partly because of the role he played in Paris at the time of his arrival. Oh yes, I was going to tell you the Napoleon story, if you could just bear with me for a second. The other thing that he funded beside the fall of Venice, besides the French monarchy, was the École Militaire, the French military school, with the proceeds of his lottery. One of the first students to go there was a young Corsican named Napoleon Bonaparte. And so he went there at the age of 16 or 17, thanks to the money that Casanova's lottery had used to finance it. 10 years later, that same Napoleon Bonaparte conquered Venice. And when I say conquered Venice, that was the end of the Venetian Republic after 1,000 years. He had so much contempt for Venice that he wouldn't even enter it himself after his soldiers had defeated it. He sent the Josephine in to tour it and wouldn't set foot in it himself. So that's how Casanova inadvertently brought about the end of his beloved Venice. Yes?
How many children did he think he
had? Well put. You know, nobody really knew. This was before DNA. He thought he had 8 children.
8.
And he talks about a son he had, and he was so intelligent, and they spent a lot of time together, and they had such rapport. He talks with feeling about him. He talks about a daughter he claimed he seduced, but he really wasn't sure if this woman was his daughter or not. And other people had the same problem, because if they met a former lover or a mistress or somebody, and they tried to figure out, you know, by the calendar, well, we were together, you know, but that was about the only system they had for telling, you know, who belonged to whom. So Casanova credited himself with 8 children. We don't really know.
Did he maintain any contact with these women later?
With who?
Women.
Lovers from the past. Yes, on some occasions. Some of them avoided him. Occasionally, occasionally they would write him letters. He was often fleeing them, but there were a few he stayed in touch with all the way until the end. There was a rather poignant romance he had with a woman named Francesca Puschini, who was barely literate, who wrote Casanova a lot of love letters. And she lived in Venice, and in his later years, he would occasionally slip back into Venice when it was safe. It was generally persona non grata there. Visit her briefly, and then leave again. And that's an example of that went on for years, kind of very occasionally.
Maybe one more question.
Is there another one?
Yes. Larry, I wonder if you'd say something about how married women were cloistered within their home, but they could disappear in a gondola, and there was a code of secrecy among the gondoliers, so that no gondolier could tell another gondolier where they took their passenger.
Right. Venice, as you know, was a city of many secrets. Gondolas had a cabin in the middle with Venetian blinds. So that people could carry on in the gondolas without being seen. So secrecy was very important and hard to come by in Venice. So women did have this status of being able to be invisible for a while and carry on, as you said.
Thank you so much. Okay.